Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a free, complete course for the CCNA. If you like these videos, please subscribe to follow along with the series. Also, please like and leave a comment, and share the video to help spread this free series of videos. Thanks for your help. Also, remember to download this practice lab from the link in the video description, and try it out yourself in PacketTracer. If you want more labs like these, I highly recommend picking up Boson's NetSim for the CCNA. Click the link in the video description to check it out. It's a network simulator like PacketTracer, but it's even better, and it includes all of these guided labs to not only help you get hands-on practice configuring and troubleshooting, but also deepen your understanding of the exam topics. I used it myself when studying for my certifications, so I feel confident about recommending it to all of you. Watch until the end of this video for a preview of a lab from NetSim. And if you want to get your own copy of NetSim, please follow the link in the video description. Okay, in the lab instructions for today's lab, I mentioned that you should turn off link lights in PacketTracer. That's because, if you can see the link lights, you will know which interfaces are in a forwarding state and which are in a blocking state. To turn them off, which I already have, click on Options up here, then Preferences, then make sure Show Link Lights is disabled. By the way, I assume you've already studied and understood the process I taught in the lecture video, so this will just be a fairly quick walkthrough. If you have forgotten some concepts like bridge ID, root cost, etc., please watch the lecture video again to review before trying this exercise. So the first portion of this lab is the same as the practice quiz questions we did at the end of the lecture video. Identify the root bridge, then identify the spanning tree port role of each switch interface, either root, designated, or non-designated. But since we're in PacketTracer, we can now use the CLI to confirm our answers. I didn't want to make the lecture video too long, so I didn't show any CLI commands, so please watch this video to see which commands you can use to confirm spanning tree. First up, which switch is the root bridge? First, we must compare the bridge priorities, and if there is a tie, compare the MAC addresses. Those are the two components of the spanning tree bridge ID, and the switch with the lowest bridge ID becomes the root bridge. In this case, the answer is fairly obvious. Switch 3 has the lowest priority, 24577, so it will be the root bridge. So we now know the port role of each interface on switch 3. All of its interfaces must be designated ports, because it is the root bridge. Just to make things easier to remember, let me make labels. Click on the Note button up here, and let me make 4 Ds for designated. Okay, and after you have made them, let's move them into position. Okay, so all 4 interfaces on switch 3 are designated ports. Next up, let's find the root ports. Each other switch in the topology must have a single root port. The first criteria to determine the root port is the root cost. The interface with the lowest root cost will become the root port. How about switch 1? Via either F01 or F02, it would have a cost of 19, plus 4 for switch 1's G01, and plus 4 for switch 4's G02, so 27. Via F03 or F04, it has a cost of just 19. So the root port will be either F03 or F04, but we don't know which, so let's look at the tiebreaker, neighbor bridge ID. Well, both are connected to the same switch, switch 3, so that is a tie as well. The final tiebreaker is the neighbor switch's port ID. The lowest one wins. It's important to remember that this isn't the local switch's port ID. It's not switch 1's port ID. It's the neighbor switch's port ID, switch 3's port ID. F01 is lower, so that means switch 1's F04 interface will be the root port. Let me create that label. And then I will move it over to switch 1. Okay, next, which will be switch 2's root port? F03 is directly connected to the root bridge, so it might look obvious that this will be the root port. However, via F03, it has a root cost of 19. Via G01, it has a root cost of 4 plus 4 for switch 4's G02, so only 8. Therefore, G01 will be the root port. That also means we can label Switch4's G01 interface as designated. The interface connected to a root port is always designated. So Switch4's root port is now obvious. Since G01 is designated, its other port, G02, must be the root port. It also has a very low cost, only 4. Okay, so we have found and labeled all of the root ports. Next up, in each remaining collision domain, we must determine which side will be designated and which will be non-designated. First up, two very obvious ones. Switch 1's F03 is connected to the root bridge, so it must be non-designated. The same goes for Switch 2's F03. It is connected directly to Switch 3, so it is non-designated. Switch 3's port is already designated. All that remain are F01 and F02 on Switch 1 and Switch 2. The first criteria is the root cost. The interfaces on the switch with the lower root cost will be designated. The other side will be non-designated. Switch 1's root cost is 19 via F04. However, Switch 2's root cost is 8 via G01. So Switch 2 has the lower root cost. Therefore, its F01 and F02 interfaces will both be designated. The other side, Switch 1's F01 and F02, will both be non-designated in a blocking state. Now that we've figured out the answers, let's actually check by using the CLI. Let's go on the root bridge, Switch 3 first. So enter privileged exec mode with enable, and the first command I want to show you is show spanning tree. At the top here, it shows the VLAN number. If there were multiple VLANs on these switches, you would see all of this information listed separately for each VLAN. In fact, you can filter the output of this command to show a single VLAN like this. Show spanning tree VLAN 1. But we only have a single VLAN, so it doesn't matter here. Under that, spanning tree enabled protocol IEEE. This means we are using the classic spanning tree. Actually, it's Cisco's PVST, but this means it's in classic mode rather than the newer rapid spanning tree, which we will look at in a future video. Then there are two big sections, root ID, which lists information about this spanning tree's root bridge, and bridge ID, which lists information about this switch's information. In this case, Switch 3 is the root bridge, so they are the same, with a few differences in the information they present. Under root ID, it just lists the priority of 24577. But down here, it shows that really, it's the priority of 24576 plus the extended system ID of 1 for VLAN 1. In the root ID section, it clearly states, this bridge is the root. Then there are some timers listed. I'll talk about these timers in the next lecture video. Finally, at the bottom, each interface participating in spanning tree is listed. You can see the role, status, cost, interface ID, and interface type. And I won't talk about the interface type in this course, by the way. It's not necessary. So, because this is the root bridge, we expect all interfaces to be designated ports and to be forwarding. As you can see, they are, so we were correct. Now, before moving to another switch, let me briefly show another couple commands. Show spanning tree detail lists similar information to show spanning tree, but as you might expect, with more details. I won't go through everything here, but feel free to take a look if you want. And one more command. Show spanning tree summary. This lists each VLAN and shows how many interfaces are in each STP state. I told you about blocking and forwarding already, but these two here, listening and learning, are transitional states, which I will teach you about in the next video. The final column, STP active, just lists how many interfaces are STP activated in total. By default, every interface that is connected to another device and enabled will have STP running. Next, let's take a look at switch 1. Enter privileged exec mode with enable, show spanning tree. As expected, F04 is the root port and is forwarding, and the other interfaces are blocking. Note that slightly different terminology is used here, alternate instead of non-designated, but the meaning is the same. Also notice that the root ID section shows Switch 3's information. But now the bridge ID information is different. This is Switch 1's own information. So our answers for switch 1 were correct. Next up, let's go to switch 2. Enable show spanning tree. Looks like we were correct again. F01 and F02 connected to switch 1 are both designated and in a forwarding state. Although really, these connections are disabled because switch 1 is blocking those ports. F03 is blocking, and G01 is the root port. By the way, something I should have mentioned before, the cost displayed here is just the cost of this interface, not the total root cost, so it only displays 4 here. If you want to see the total root cost, use this command I showed you. Show spanning tree detail. Here it says, cost of root path is 8, because there are 2 gigabit Ethernet interfaces in the path. Finally, let's check on switch 4. Enable show spanning tree. So G01 is designated, and G02 is the root port. So we successfully calculated the spanning tree topology. That's all for this lab. Next up, let's take a look at a lab in Boson NetSim. Okay, for today's Boson NetSim for CCNA lab preview, I will once again do something a little bit different. Here in the network access section of NetSim for CCNA, you'll notice there are no labs for spanning tree. Why is that? Why does Boson not include spanning tree in NetSim for CCNA? Well, let's check the exam topics list. These are the exam topics for the CCNA, 200-301, current version. 2.5. Describe the need for and basic operations of Rapid PVST Plus spanning tree protocol, and identify basic operations. So describe and identify. There's no mention of configure, like these other topics. Configure, 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 configure. This one, describe and identify. So according to the exam topics list, spanning tree configuration is not on the CCNA exam. So that's probably why Boson didn't include it in NetSim for CCNA. However, I still think it's a good idea to get some hands-on practice in the CLI, observing and configuring spanning tree. So that's why I include labs in my course. However, if we check out the CCNP Encore 350-401 exam topics list, here, 3.1c, configure and verify common spanning tree protocols. So configuration is included in the CCNP exam topics list. So instead of a CCNA, NetSim for CCNA lab, let's do a NetSim for CCNP Encore lab. There are quite a few spanning tree labs here, starting here, spanning tree 1, all the way down to here, implementing multiple spanning tree protocol. The one we're going to take a look at today is this one, simply titled Spanning Tree Protocol. Click on the lab and click Load Lab. But I've already done that, so lab instructions. So there are 4 switches here. P1 A switch 1, A switch 2, P1 D switch 1, D switch 2. A switch means access switch, access layer switch. And D switch is distribution layer switch. These are 2 common layers of network design, good network designs. And I haven't actually talked about them yet in my course, so you can wait for that in the future. Just know their meaning now. Access switch, distribution switch. Notice the hosts connect to the access switches, and then the access switches connect to the distribution switches. Okay, so just for today's preview, I will do this step here, step 1. On P1, D switch 1, issue the show spanning tree VLAN 1 detail. I just showed you this command, show spanning tree detail. To display the spanning tree for VLAN 1, use the output to answer the following questions. So let's go into the CLI of D switch 1 here. Click on the device and click on console. Okay, and we're in. Enable show spanning tree VLAN 1 detail. Okay. So question A, which spanning tree is VLAN 1 executing? We aren't actually going to do any configuration in this step, by the way. This is just answering questions. And actually, that's something I really like about NetSim. They ask you good questions to really test your understanding of the topic. So anyway, which spanning tree? It says it right here. VLAN 1 is executing the IEEE compatible spanning tree protocol. This means classic spanning tree protocol, the one I taught you in the lecture video. This is not rapid spanning tree protocol. Okay, so that's the answer, regular classic spanning tree. B, what are the priority sysid? This is the extended system ID, the VLAN number, and MAC address. They are stated here. Bridge identifier, bridge ID, has priority 24576, sysid 1, which actually gets added to the priority, so it's really 24577 in total. And this is the MAC address. So that's question B. Why is there no root port? Well, let's confirm. Is there a root port? Here, fast Ethernet 01 is designated forwarding, so it's not a root port, it's a designated port. 02, designated. 03, designated. Designated, designated, and designated. So there are, in fact, no root ports. Why is that? Well, the answer is here. We are the root of the spanning tree. This switch is the root bridge. As you know, every port, every interface on the root bridge must be designated. So that's why there are no root ports. So that's C. And then D, why are there no blocked ports for VLAN 1? Well, that's the same reason, because it's the root. There will be no block ports on the root bridge. They should all be designated ports in a forwarding state. Okay, E, what is the timer value for sending BPDUs, bridge protocol data units? So I haven't talked about the timers yet in the lecture video. So I will talk about them in the next lecture video, day 21. But the answer is here, configured hello time. Hello time is the interval at which it sends those BPDUs. They're called hello BPDUs. So 2 means every 2 seconds. So it will send one BPDU every 2 seconds. What is the maximum age for a BPDU? Here it is, 20 seconds. Again, I will talk about this maximum age timer in the next video. And what is the value of the forward delay timer? It is 15 seconds. Oh, sorry. There we go, 15 seconds. These are the defaults, 2, 20, 15. Okay, so that's the answer for G. Okay, so there is one more step here to this lab, and then lab solutions, highlighting all the different outputs you can see. Pretty much everything we just looked at. Yeah, okay. So there it is, Boson NetSim. If you want to get a copy of Boson NetSim for CCNA, and I highly recommend you do, look at all these guided labs they have here for all the exam topics. From network fundamentals, network access, IP connectivity, IP services, security fundamentals. So if you can, I highly recommend getting a copy of NetSim for CCNA. If you want a copy, please follow the link in the video description. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to the channel, like the video, leave a comment, and share the video with anyone else studying for the CCNA. If you want to leave a tip, check the links in the description. I'm also a Brave verified publisher and accept BAT or Basic Attention Token tips via the Brave browser. That's all for now.